And now let's go back to the McKimmon Center, where Julie Hendry is standing by live and Dr. Carl Sagan is about to begin.
Yes, Jill, Dr. Sagan has not yet begun his speech. Speaking right now is Roy Park, who is the chairman and CEO of Park Communications Incorporated of Ithaca, New York. Mr. Park is a North Carolina native. He is doing the introduction for Dr. Sagan. We'll join his speech now.
Last Sunday's piece, which was entitled, Too Many Weapons in the World. His television series, Cosmos, won an Emmy and a Peabody Award and had the largest audience in the history of American public television. And by the way, I understand that we are on public television tonight, and we own some North Carolina stations, including one that I own. That was a little hard to get done. Dr. Sagan won a Pulitzer Prize for his book, The Dragons of Eden. And his book, Cosmos, topped the New York Times bestseller list for 70 weeks. It's better than a year and 3 months. And remains the best-selling science book ever published in English. Since Dr. Sagan and I are both residents of Ithaca, New York, and I can tell you a few things about him you may not know. Dr. Sagan's home on the Gorge, that's what we call it, home on the Gorge, is one of the most unique locations in Ithaca. It's built into the rim of our largest gorge, overlooking the city and Cayuga Lake. His front door is at street level, and it's up where it would be the average three-story house's attic, because he goes down flights of stairs to reach his living room, which has large picture windows opening onto a patio above the gorge. Years ago, the original portion of the house on the gorge was the home of a Cornell secret honorary fraternity, the Sphinx Head, and was called the Tomb. The fraternity was disbanded, and when Dr. Sagan acquired the property, he added the present living quarters. And I want to tell you that it wasn't a secret house of evil or anything. It was the home of the high scholars at Cornell. It's still a tourist attraction in Ithaca, and folks slow down to a crawl when they come off the bridge to see above the house. They see from above the house and a yard and catch a glimpse of Carl. That's what they hope to do, but he's not around very much. He travels a great deal. By conservative estimate, he logged several hundred thousand miles in the past 3 years. I often know when Dr. Sagan is in town, though, because I drive by his house on the way to work every day and can see whether or not his Volkswagen is parked on the street level by the entrance. When he is in town, I frequently run into him because he likes Japanese food and we share a favorite Japanese restaurant in Ithaca called Utage. Dr. Sagan is very much in demand as a speaker. In fact, he's able to accept only a handful of the hundreds of invitations to speak that he gets each year. So we are in pretty tall cotton here tonight, as we used to say back when we raised cotton in North Carolina. One thing is certain, he's a gracious gentleman. When Governor Hunt called me to ask if I would invite Dr. Sagan to speak tonight, I started at the top and called the president of Cornell University, Dr. Frank Rhodes. Dr. Rhodes was in England, and his secretary was reluctant to tell me where Dr. Sagan was. I then called Dr. Rhodes' administrative assistant, who told me she would contact Dr. Sagan and have him call me. Dr. Sagan returned the call from the Jet Propulsion Laboratories at California Institute of Technology, where he is the distinguished visiting scientist. In just a few minutes, we worked out the details for his participation in the Emergent Issues Forum. In Ithaca, we all know that Carl Sagan is a scientist who, while he may have his eyes on the heavens, his feet are firmly planted on the ground. He is best known member of the Cornell University's highly prestigious faculty, one which includes 2 Nobel Prize recipients. He's become a compelling and influential spokesman on the important environmental issues which face all of us living on the planet, on this planet. So I'm especially proud to have been an intermediary in bringing Dr. Carl Sagan as a speaker for this forum of emerging issues, and I am certain that the story he tells you will be an interesting and informative one. Please join in giving me a warm North Carolina welcome for Dr. Carl Sagan.
Governor Hunt, Mr. Park, thank you very much for your extremely generous introduction. My friends, I'm very happy to be here with you. I think the idea of a state organizing a concentrated look on the critical issues of our day involving leaders and ordinary people statewide is extremely important, and I'd like to see this emulated in the other 49 states and maybe 159 other countries. In general, I think it's an excellent idea. And choosing the issue of global change, I think, is extremely important, because here's an issue where the risk is very high. The issue is removed from everyday life. The solutions cannot take place in the course of a year or two. It involves scientific issues which are distant from the familiar everyday acquaintance of many people. And for this constellation of reasons, it poses difficult public policy issues. My own involvement with the issue of global warming did not begin on this, well, I certainly began on this lovely world, but my interest in global warming began in the study of a different world, Venus, our nearest planetary neighbor. It's been my great good fortune to have not only witnessed, but to have participated in the historic first preliminary reconnaissance of the solar system in which we live. Beginning in 1962, when the United States launched the first successful interplanetary vehicle, Mariner 2, we humans, mainly Americans and Soviets, have sent spacecraft to visit all the planets known to the ancients, to our ancestors, and many other worlds besides. We have examined many dozens of other worlds, a few of them in great detail, having landed on their surfaces, and most flying by at great speed, but with instruments of enormous capability, taking the data as we speed past. An enormous amount of important and interesting information has been acquired. The perspective that we get about those other worlds illuminates a wide range of science. One of the issues that I've been most focused on, concerned about, is the issue of life elsewhere. And it's certainly a fair summary to say that in these dozens of worlds, while we have many cases of pre-biological organic matter, the stirrings and intimations of life, if you wish, nevertheless, there is nothing, not the least hint, of anything alive on those other worlds. I spent over a year, in a manner of speaking, on the planet Mars in 1976-77 after the Viking spacecraft, two of them, landed on Mars. And we had an armory of instrumentation to look for life. There was nothing, not a mouse, not a footprint, not a microbe, not even an organic molecule. The lesson is that you can have dozens of worlds, some of them of breathtaking splendor and beauty, without life on any of them. Life is something rare and precious. There is something extraordinary about the planet that we are privileged to live on, and in this peculiarly self-congratulatory way, about we ourselves. Life is rare. That's the lesson from exploring space. And the lesson from exploring time, if you look back in the geological record at the history of mass extinctions, is that there is no guaranteed tenure for any species, no matter how self-confident on this planet. 65 million years ago, an event occurred which not only wiped out all the dinosaurs, but wiped out most of the species of life on Earth. This can happen to anyone. These explorations in space and time are a reminder or a warning to us that we cannot be guaranteed of our continued happy existence. It's important to understand our world, and I argue others as well. When we look at Venus, we find a world of roughly the same size, mass, density as ours, but a stunning difference, two stunning differences. One is that there's a massive atmosphere, about 90 times the surface pressure of the air right here down on Earth. And the other is that the surface temperature is stunningly hot. The surface of Venus is at 900 degrees Fahrenheit, hot enough to melt tin or lead, hotter than the hottest household oven. And it's not because Venus is a little closer to the sun, because the clouds of Venus are brighter than the Earth is, and Venus reflects so much more light back to space relative to the Earth that it ought to be cooler, not warmer, than the Earth. Why is Venus at 900 degrees Fahrenheit? Because of the greenhouse effect. That massive atmosphere is made mostly of carbon dioxide, and a large amount of carbon dioxide can trap the heat and warm a planet. Warm it to certainly very uncomfortable levels. This is, I claim, a kind of providential warning to us. I'm not for a moment suggesting that there was once a species of Venusians who refused to drive fuel-efficient automobiles, and this is what happened to their planet. The story is, in fact, even more interesting than that, but I won't go into it here. But the lesson is not only that a greenhouse effect can exist, but that a large greenhouse effect can be exceptionally dangerous. So for anyone who views our exquisite planet and hears the warnings of scientists and says, all this greenhouse stuff is just some theory, I ask them to reflect on the fate of the planet Venus, our nearest planetary neighbor. By the way, while I'm not going to be talking about it, or at least not much today, Mars is an example of what happens when you don't have an ozone layer. The reason we think that we could find not only no trace of life, but not even an organic molecule on the surface of Mars, is that Mars has a planet-wide ozone hole, so to say. Negligible ozone, ultraviolet light from the sun strikes the surface unimpeded. The surface becomes rich in fabulously oxidizing molecules, and they simply gobble up any organic matter that happens to be there. Mars is also a salutary warning to us, we who are pushing and pulling and tugging on a planetary environment which we still insufficiently understand. Well, many of you have attended the sessions today. I was privileged to be able to listen to a few of the extraordinarily interesting papers presented. You know something of the evidence for greenhouse warming, the predicted consequences, the disasters for agriculture, the rise in sea level. I will say a little bit about the evidence later. But I want to ask you to think about the following general, very practical political issue. What happens when a group of scientists makes some prediction of impending disaster? Keep doing such and such, they say, and the following catastrophe will result. And changing that catastrophe, averting it, mitigating it, is going to be expensive. It might require changing the way we think, in which case it's politically expensive, or it might involve changing the way we do business, in which case it is fiscally expensive. One way or another, it's expensive. At what point do policymakers have to take this seriously? This is an issue that is extremely current today. And I'd like to just spend a few minutes on two examples from the rich cultural history of our species of policymakers and predictions of disaster, and I will reach to ancient Greece. Both of these stories can be found in the classic Greek literature, the first in Herodotus, the second in Aeschylus's play Agamemnon. They both are at least in part based on historical events. The first case that I want to tell you about is Croesus, king of Lydia. Apollo was the god of the sun, but in addition to being in charge of sunlight, he had another specialty, and that was being in charge of prophecy. Not just generalized prophecy, but systematic prophecy in human institutions called oracles, the most famous of which was the oracle at Delphi. And the way it would work is you would go to Delphi as a supplicant, you would bring some gifts for the priestess, who was called the Pythia, you would say what your concern is, and then from the Pythia, usually in a kind of trance, back would come the advice from the gods, or at least from Apollo. Now, Croesus was immensely rich. There's still a phrase, rich as Croesus. It's almost current, just a little obsolete. One of the reasons he was so rich is that he was one of the boys who invented money. The first metal coins in human history, as far as we know, were coined in Lydia in Croesus's reign. Lydia is in Anatolia, contemporary Turkey. Well, we can speculate on the reason, but Croesus's ambitions were not contained within the boundaries of his small nation. He had grander objectives, and so he thought, wouldn't it be a good idea to conquer Persia? Persia was the superpower of the 7th century BC. The Persian emperor Cyrus had forged a mighty empire by combining two different peoples, the Persians and the Medes. So, Croesus had some degree of trepidation because of the power of the Persian Empire, so naturally he sent emissaries to the oracle at Delphi. And the question put by his emissaries on Croesus's behalf was, what will happen if Croesus makes war on Persia? And without hesitation, the Pythia, the priestess, answered, he will destroy a mighty empire. The gods are with us, thought Croesus. Time to invade. So he assembled a vast mercenary army, invaded Persia, and was promptly and humiliatingly defeated. And his not only was Lydian power destroyed forever, but he, Croesus, was forced to spend the rest of his life as a sort of pathetic minor functionary in the Persian court, a hanger-on ex-king. It's a little bit like, this isn't a perfect analogy, but it's a little bit like the Emperor Hirohito living out his days as a consultant on the Beltway in Washington, D.C. Well, the injustice of it really got to him. After all, Croesus had played by the rules. He had asked for advice from the Pythia, and she gave it to him, he acted on it, and look what happened. She had done him wrong. So, after mulling this over for some years, he sent another emissary to Delphi, this one bearing much less opulent gifts, as was appropriate to his now greatly diminished station. And he asked, how could you do this to me? And here from Herodotus's history is the answer from the god. Quote, the prophecy given by Apollo ran that if Croesus made war upon Persia, he would destroy a mighty empire. Now in the face of that, said the priestess, if he had been well advised, he should have sent and inquired again whether it was his own empire or that of Cyrus that was spoken of. But Croesus did not understand what was said, nor did he ask questions again, and so he has no one to blame but himself. So much for Croesus. Now, if the Delphic Oracle was just a kind of institutionalized scam to fleece credulous kings, then of course it would have needed excuses to explain away the inevitable mistakes. Disguised ambiguities are the stock in trade of oracles. Nevertheless, the lesson of the Pythia is germane. Even of oracles, we must ask intelligent questions. Even, or especially, when they tell us what we want to hear. The policymakers must not blindly accept. They have to understand. They have to ask questions. They must not let their own ambitions stand in the way of understanding. The conversion of prophecy into policy must be done with care. And it seems to me this advice is fully applicable to the modern oracles, the scientists and think tanks and universities. Sometimes the policymakers ask them, and the prophecy comes back. More often these days, the oracles voluntarily submit, even to those who never asked them. And then the policymakers, have to figure out, what'll I do now? And since the modern oracles are deeply immersed in science and technology, it's very important for the policymakers and the people who determine who the policymakers are to understand science and technology. So this is on the one hand. Now I want to tell you a on the other hand story, also from classical Greece. This is also about Apollo and also about oracles. This is the story of Cassandra, princess of Troy. The event occurs just before the Trojan War begins. The one that Homer wrote about. She was the smartest and the most beautiful of the daughters of King Priam. And Apollo, who, like all the Greek gods, was constantly on the prowl for attractive humans, fell in love with her. At least that's the way the story is described. Oddly, this almost never happens in Greek myth, she resisted his advances. She was smart, she was beautiful, she was happy. Who needed Apollo? So he tried to bribe her. But what could he give her? She was already a princess. She had everything that she wanted. Apollo thought of something she didn't have. He promised her the gift of prophecy. The offer was irresistible. She agreed, quid pro quo. Apollo did whatever it is that gods do to create seers, oracles, and prophets out of mere mortals. And then, after he had done that, scandalously, Cassandra reneged. She changed her mind. She refused the overtures of a god. Apollo was not amused. But he couldn't withdraw the gift of prophecy because whatever else you want to say about Greek gods, they keep their promises. So instead, he condemned her to an ingenious and cruel fate that no one would believe her prophecies. So Cassandra predicts the invasion by the Greeks headed by Agamemnon. Nobody pays attention. She predicts the fall of Troy. Nobody pays attention. She predicts to the Greeks the death of Agamemnon. They pay no attention. She predicts her own death. Nobody pays any attention to that. Instead, they make fun of her. They call her the Lady of Many Sorrows. Today, it would be something like Prophet of Gloom and Doom. Just minor translational difference, same sentiment. I prophesied to my countrymen, she says, all their disasters. But they ignored her prophecies. They were destroyed. Agamemnon was destroyed, and soon so was she. Well, this resistance to dire prediction is very human, and we can certainly see it today. I mean, if we're faced with some very heavy, ominous prediction, things you never saw happen are going to happen, and it's going to be expensive to mitigate it, we have a natural tendency to reject or ignore the prophecy. And after all, there are no prophets, not even the scientific community, who are right all the time. And you can find competent scientists who have made predictions, supersonic transports will destroy the ozone layer, for example, that are just wrong. And so it's very easy to dismiss. Also, if the factors precipitating the anticipated catastrophe are long-standing, then the prediction is a kind of rebuke to us. How did we permit this peril to develop? Why didn't we see it beforehand? Why didn't we take political steps to prevent it? So these are uncomfortable ruminations that through our own inattention or inaction, some catastrophe is coming. Put it out of our mind. So this, or find a reason to reject it. This temptation to minimize, to dismiss, is something that psychiatrists know very well about. They have a technical name for it. It's called denial. Denial. The rock group Dire Straits, I'm sure many of you know their repertoire, has a line in one of their songs which goes, "Denial ain't just a river in Egypt." So these two cases, I claim, are the opposite poles of policy response to predictions of disaster. Croesus, representing the pole of sort of credulous, uncritical acceptance propelled a little bit by greed or other character flaws. And Cassandra, representing, I mean the response to her, representing the pole of stolid, immobile rejection of the possibility of danger. Well, today we have a set of such prophecies. And for all the average person understands, they could just as well have emanated from the Delphic Oracle for all the fundamental understanding of the underpinnings there is. So it gets to be a kind of challenge, a battle between two arguments from authority. There's one bunch, they're sort of nice looking, they say it's worrisome. There's this other bunch, they're sort of nice looking, they say it's not worrisome. What'll I choose? Well, I'll choose the one that's most comfortable. I think we are much closer to the danger of Cassandra than of the danger of Croesus. Now, let me give a very brief statement of why I take greenhouse warming so seriously. Those of you who have attended the sessions this morning, this afternoon, have heard a much more detailed expert summary of these reasons. First of all, there is no question that such a thing as a greenhouse effect exists. I talked about Venus. This benign planet, looking exactly as it does here, but with no greenhouse effect, would be 20 degrees centigrade, that's what, 36 Fahrenheit, below the freezing point of water. With no greenhouse effect, this planet would be frozen solid. The oceans would be 3 kilometers of ice. A little greenhouse effect is a good thing. We owe our lives to the greenhouse effect. No greenhouse effect, we would never have come into being. The principal greenhouse gases are water vapor and carbon dioxide. Now, there are some minor constituents, methane, oxides of nitrogen, and chlorofluorocarbons, which go by the brand name freons. And they are an especially interesting aspect of this because they are wholly man-made. You see, astronauts, many of them, in Earth orbit, seeing to the naked, unaided eye, this beautiful vista, can make out, as perhaps is hard to do in this picture, the very thin blue aura that surrounds the bright hemisphere, the illuminated hemisphere of the Earth. And that's just the thin atmosphere seen edge on. This phrase, the ocean of air, is a kind of misnomer. Ocean suggests massive, impervious. But instead, that thin line that you can barely make out in this picture is very fragile, vulnerable to the depredations of human beings. Our technology and our numbers have both reached a state where inadvertently we can pose a danger to the global environment, especially through the atmosphere. The abundance of greenhouse gases is increasing. Greenhouse gases act as a kind of blanket holding the heat in. There is no question that all of the gases I just mentioned are steadily increasing in abundance. In addition, it seems very clear that the average temperature of the Earth has been increasing through the 20th century. It's a noisy record. There are hot years and cold years always, so the curve of temperature versus time has a jagged aspect to it, but the slow increase with time is becoming increasingly clear, and one indication of that is that the 5 hottest years of the 20th century were in the decade of the 1980s. And that is also the decade which had the highest abundance of all of those greenhouse gases. In addition, there is most interesting evidence from an Antarctic ice core taken by a Soviet team in which the past temperature history of the Earth for tens of thousands of years and the past abundance of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere can both be measured. They're little bubbles of air that are trapped in the ice, laminated between successive snowfalls. And we find that when the carbon dioxide is higher, the temperatures are higher. When the carbon dioxide is lower, the temperatures are lower. There is a virtually one-to-one correlation. Now, nobody pretends we understand everything about the global climate. There are feedbacks, some of which you warm the Earth a little bit, and the tendency will be to further increase the temperature, so-called positive feedback, and others in which you warm the Earth a little, and the situation is self-correcting, like a thermostat, and it cools the Earth a little. And there is a push and pull, a tug, between these competing feedbacks. Doubtless, we have not identified all of them. The present consensus, I believe, is that the bad kind of feedback, the ones that make things worse, the so-called positive feedbacks, dominate. I would think it would be an astonishing coincidence if the balance of all these feedbacks just exactly corrected the problem that we are generating through human technology, a kind of deus ex machina, to go back to the Greek analogies. You know, in the Greek plays, when the playwright got himself into a plot pickle and couldn't figure out how to resolve it, then there was an actor on wires representing a god who flew into the set and put everything right. It was called Deus Ex Machina, the god of the machine, from the machine being the device that plopped him down on the stage. It's asking a lot to believe that the problem is going to fix itself. If we look at the prognostications, the three-dimensional general circulation computer models, of which there are some six independent models working right now, mainly in the United States, one in UK, they all predict temperature increases of a few degrees centigrade between now and the middle of the next century. And the difference between them is only a factor of two in temperature rise. None of the models predict that the Earth climate's going to get cooler. None of them predict it's going to be tens or hundreds of degrees increase. The agreement, considering the state of our knowledge, is quite good. If you then look at the output of these computer models, which purport to give a sense of how the temperatures change on a regional basis as you go through time, you begin to see some very worrisome things. Yes, there are some places that get cooler and some places that get warmer, but the overall trend is warmer. And by the middle of the 21st century, there's no winner. Every place has gotten warmer. And to give you an idea of how much warmer, I mean, a few degrees centigrade global change doesn't sound like so much. Let me point out that a 1 degree temperature change, in this case decrease, following a massive volcanic explosion is enough to produce widespread suffering and famine worldwide, as happened following the Tambora explosion, volcanic explosion in 1815, and other cases which are still more serious. Several degrees is a very major temperature increase. And some of these predictions prognosticate that the American Midwest will be converted into something approaching scrub desert by the second half of the 21st century, and likewise the Soviet Ukraine and so on. But the American Midwest is the breadbasket of the world. If the grain and cereal foodstuffs from those places are unavailable, we are in serious trouble. In addition, through the volume expansion of seawater, the melting of glacial and polar ice, sea levels rise. And again, there's an uncertainty. Average prediction for the middle of next century is 1 meter, 3 feet. But it might be as little as 1, and it might be as much as many meters. And then take a look at all the low-lying coastlines all around the world and ask what happens when the sea level rises. Okay, the Dutch, they're very good at building dikes and levees. They'll build more dikes and levees. That's not going to destroy Holland. But take a look at Bangladesh, where 1 to 3 meter temperature rise will flood an area which is inhabited by tens of millions of people. Where are those guys going to go? Environmental refugees. It's a new prospect. For these reasons, I take very seriously the prediction of greenhouse warming. Now, there are policy makers who would like to respond as follows, and you have perhaps seen this sort of opinion on the pages of, naturally, the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal. That's the first place to expect a complaint about having to change anything. It's too uncertain, they say. This is serious stuff. A few scientists with computer models, and who can be sure that they know what they're talking about? And you want us to turn everything upside down because some scientists say that things are going to get a few degrees warmer? It's a few degrees warmer on the stage than it is in the audience. You don't see any catastrophe up here, do you? I'd like to pose the following question. Imagine this kind of thinking back in the height of the Cold War. You know, the United States, so let me ask a question. How much money do you think the United States has spent since 1945 on the Cold War? Sometimes I ask this question and from the back of the audience comes an answer, billions and billions. A huge underestimate, billions and billions. The amount of money that the United States has spent on the Cold War since 1945 is approximately $10 trillion. Trillion, that's the big one, with the T. What could you buy for $10 trillion? The answer is, you could buy everything in the United States except the land. Everything. Every building, truck, bus, car, boat, plane, pencil, baby's diaper. Everything in the United States except the land. That's what we've spent on the Cold War. So now let me ask, how certain was it that the Russians were going to invade? Was it 100% certain? Guess not, since they never invaded. What if it was only, let's say, 10% certain? What would advocates of big military buildup have said? They would have said, we must be prudent. It's not enough to count on only the most likely circumstance. If the worst happens, and it's really extremely dangerous for us, we have to prepare for that. Remote contingencies, if they're serious enough, have to be prepared for. It's classic military thinking. You prepare for the worst case. And so now I ask my friends who were comfortable with that argument, including the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal, why doesn't that same argument apply to global warming? You don't think it's 100% likely? Fine, you're entitled to think that. If it's only a small probability of it happening, since the consequences are so serious, don't you have to make some serious investment to prevent it or mitigate it? I think there's a double standard of argument working, and I don't think we should permit it. Now, let me indicate What is it you would do if you took greenhouse warming seriously? And what I'm going to try to argue is that virtually every one of the things that you would do to ameliorate greenhouse warming make sense on completely separate grounds. They are worth doing apart from greenhouse warming. Unlike the defense buildup, which made no sense whatever, except if you were confident that there was a real danger of Soviet troops pouring across the Elbe. There was no other mitigating circumstances. The least efficient way to spend money if you want to pump the national economy. It drew all sorts of scientific as well as fiscal resources out of the civilian economy. It is largely responsible for the economic chaos of the United States. Whereas, I will argue, spending money on mitigating greenhouse warming makes an enormous amount of sense for other reasons. What are the mitigating steps? First, the greenhouse gas that is increasing most steeply is the CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons. It would make a great deal of sense to simply wipe them out, prevent any more production of CFCs. Well, because CFCs also imperil the ozone layer, there is already not just a commitment from the major manufacturers of CFCs to stop producing them, but there is an international agreement called the Montreal Protocol, which most of the major industrial nations have signed, committing themselves to phase out CFC production by the turn of the millennium, by the year 2000. That's an example of what can be done on these global environmental issues. And since CFCs are doubly dangerous, ozone depletion and greenhouse effect, the first step that you would take is in fact being done. So that's a bit of an encouragement. We're not as immobile and resistant to these arguments as you might otherwise expect. Second, energy efficiency. If you can get more power to a house from a given power plant, then for a given amount of energy expenditure, you put less carbon dioxide up into the atmosphere. Obviously, you're doing something important for greenhouse warming. One third of the carbon dioxide that is generated in the United States, the worst CO2 polluter on the planet, by the way, comes from automobiles. Why do we permit automobiles that get 15 to 25 miles a gallon when the technology exists for automobiles that get 60 to 100 miles a gallon? That's not a step which will bother anybody except possibly adolescent young men who need to have extremely rapid acceleration for psychological reasons of their own. For all practical purposes, much greater fuel efficiency in automobiles is perfectly possible. And likewise, across the entire spectrum of fossil fuel energy use in our society, fossil fuels being coal, oil, gas, wood, and so on. The stuff that when you burn it, CO2 comes out. The third thing you might want to do is to seek alternative energy sources, alternatives to fossil fuels. Why not have an energy source that doesn't put carbon dioxide or other greenhouse gases into the atmosphere? Is that wholly beyond our technological ability? I don't think so. And while there are a number of alternatives, some of which work in some places, some geographical locales and not in others, the mix looks very promising. I'm talking about tidal, geothermal, wind, and especially solar power. You know, this solar power issue is very interesting, and it has a strong political point. Maybe you remember Jimmy Carter when he was in the White House. For the young of heart in the audience, this was an early American president who preached energy efficiency. And one of the largely symbolic gestures which he did was to install a solar thermal heater in the roof of the White House to make some warm water for presidential showers. And I've forgotten what the fraction of the White House's own energy budget it accounted for. Maybe it was 15-20%, something like that. But it was a kind of step in a direction which certainly, from what we've learned subsequently, we need to go. The next president of the United States was Ronald Reagan, and one of the first acts upon entering office was to rip the solar thermal converter out of the roof of the White House. And one of the early steps taken in his administration was to enormously reduce funding for solar and other alternative energy sources. We lost 10 years. Despite that, the progress in solar energy technology has been steady and impressive. And if you were to levy an environmental tax on the burning of fossil fuels to pay for the additional burden on the society from the increase of the greenhouse effect, even today, solar energy would be economically competitive with fossil fuels. And if we were to spend some significant amount of research money on solar energy, the price per kilowatt hour would certainly go down. There is a natural issue about nuclear energy. Fusion power, which maybe we will have in another few decades, is in principle clean as far as greenhouse gases go. But there is a variety of radioactive waste and other problems which have to be dealt with. Fission power, the kind of power plants we have today, some people believe are a suitable stopgap between fossil fuels and whatever it is that we're going to have as the alternative later on. In my view, there are some conditions which have to be satisfied by fission power plants. They have to be safe. Chernobyl certainly reminds us of that. They have to be cost effective, and the prices have soared through the roof. Their radioactive wastes have to be safely disposable, not for 10 years into the future, but for hundreds or thousands, because that's the half-lives of the radioactive waste. And the fourth criterion I would use is that they must not produce weapons-grade uranium or plutonium, for separate topic, so as not to encourage the nuclear arms race. The burden of proof that fission power plants satisfy those criteria is on the shoulders of those who advocate it. I am not convinced that there's any fission power plant that satisfies those criteria. If there is, then maybe it makes sense as a stopgap. If not, we're in a tighter squeeze, and it's even more important that we spend money on the development of alternative energy sources. Now, another thing you could do is plant trees. A tree is an engine for taking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. It does it. It's not the only thing a tree does, but that's one of the things that trees are good for, and it's especially relevant to this issue. Plant forests. That seems to be good advice to mitigate greenhouse warming. Instead, the human species is destroying forests, and we're doing it at a rate of one acre of forest every second. Think of that. There goes an acre. There goes an acre. There goes an acre. There goes an acre. We're doing something immensely stupid. And then finally, and maybe the most important of all of the ways of mitigating greenhouse warming, is to deal with the world population crisis. Every human being has a right and a wish to a certain minimum way of life, and that involves cooking food. Carbon dioxide goes into the atmosphere. And all the other things that you do in your job, many of which involve more greenhouse warming. If we continue exponential population growth, it will overwhelm any of the other measures that I've been talking about, no matter how seriously they are approached. Now, what does it take to make some dent in population growth? Some people have the idea that all you have to do is just make birth control apparatus device pharmaceuticals available, and that's the issue. But that's not the issue. It's not that people, poor people, the billion poorest people on the planet, are too dumb to understand that they shouldn't have more children. That's not the issue. The issue is they are so poor that more children is a kind of social security to provide for their old age. More children is a way to have cheap labor to help with whatever dismal task on the little plot of land they work or whatever it is they're doing, that otherwise they couldn't afford. Having children is not the, having lots of children is not the cause of poverty, it is the consequence of poverty, although the causality arrow goes both ways. And the clear indication of how this works is what has been documented all over the planet called the demographic transition. It works in Christian countries and Buddhist countries, capitalist countries, and communist countries, of which there are hardly any left, but when there were, it worked there, east and west, and it's absolutely striking. When the per capita income is very low, people have lots of children. When the per capita income rises to a pathetically low level by American affluent standards, but still higher than a lot of people have, the population growth rate automatically decreases. People then see that they can provide in a minimal way for their future. They have some discretionary capital, which they then want to spend on something, and their cost-benefit analysis then works out so that they have fewer children. And maybe we can think back to our great-grandparents and remember what size families were common then and think of how much larger it was than today. Is that because they were too stupid? It's not. They made another kind of choice. Now, let me quickly run through, again, this list and just remind you of why each of these steps makes sense by themselves, even apart from greenhouse warming. Cut out the CFCs, we've already talked about that. That protects the very fragile ozone layer. Greater fuel efficiency. If for a given amount of fuel, you get more power out, that's obviously good economics. And, you know, we hear about the danger of being dependent upon foreign sources of oil. And this is used as an argument by this administration, for example, to permit ecologically dangerous offshore oil drilling. Because we have to have domestic sources. We don't want to be dependent on foreigners. But if we make much more efficient use of the oil we already have, then that's the same as discovering new sources of oil, right? And on finding alternative energy sources, clearly that works in the same direction. If we had vast solar arrays that were absorbing sunlight and converting them into electricity, then that would be an alternative to importing tankers worth of oil from some foreign country. And in addition, it's a good technology to have against the day when the oil runs out. The sun doesn't run out, or at least not for 5 billion years, and I figure that's good enough. Planting forests at the least stopping destroying forests makes enormous sense in terms of species diversity. All of those organisms, mainly plants, that we're knocking off without knowing anything about them, including their possible pharmacological and other benefit for human beings. And also, we grew up in forests, we primates. We have a natural affinity to forests. We feel better, or at least I'll speak for myself. I like being in forests. And then finally, on the population growth rate, it's very clear, I don't have to go through it for this audience, how important that is to the future stability, political and economic and foodstuffs and everything else of the planet, even apart from the ecological issues. So what I say to those who complain it's too uncertain, beyond pointing out that the standards that were applied to the Cold War are to be applied here, I say, look, every one of these steps makes good sense, makes good economic sense. And think of all the industries that are implied by what I just said, especially alternative energy sources. There is money to be made in developing a technology which will appropriately address greenhouse warming. Well, I want to stop in a moment. I just want to make one or two summary remarks. If you burn a lump of coal somewhere, the carbon dioxide goes up into the atmosphere. And you know, carbon dioxide molecules are exceptionally stupid. They don't know anything about national boundaries. They don't have passports. They are wholly innocent of the important concept of national sovereignty. They just casually cross over national boundaries one after the other. There is a lesson. The world is a unity. The national boundaries have no bearing on these global environmental issues. No one nation can solve this problem by itself. It has to be all the nations working together. What is more, there is no way to mitigate these problems so that we will introduce the mitigating technology, or whatever it is today, and in 2 or 3 or 4 years or something comparable to a political term of office, the problem will be solved. Instead, you introduce the mitigating circumstances now, and decades hence, when somebody you don't even know will be holding your political office, the benefits will come. Solving these problems requires a transnational and a transgenerational perspective. To my mind, that's a very grown-up kind of perspective. Deprovincializing, de-chauvinizing, an awareness of one species on one exquisite, fragile planet. And that's why I think that these very serious global environmental issues may have a deep silver lining, the binding up of the planet, the end of our adolescence, the approach to the maturity of our species. Thank you very much.